Good evening, everyone. My name is Amy Quarrell. I'm the Curator of Education and Public Engagement here at MOCAD, and it is my pleasure to welcome you here. This evening, in association with Mitch McEwen's Methexis exhibition, we are pleased to bring you Dawn Lundy Martin. Dawn curated a series of poetically rooted videos for Mitch's exhibition that explore architecture and language. And tonight, she's going to tell us about those videos and share some of her own work. When it comes to Dawn's own work, there is a lot of it. She's the co-director of the Center for African American Poetry and Poetics, an associate professor of English at the University of Pittsburgh. Martin received her MA in creative writing from San Francisco State University and her PhD in literature at the University of Massachusetts Amherst with a dissertation on experimentalism and subjectivity in contemporary poetry. Wow. She's the author of A Gathering of Matter, A Matter of Gathering, the University of Georgia Press in 2007. She's the winner of the Cave Canem Prize. Discipline, Nightboat Books 2011, which was selected by Fanny Howe for the Nightboat Books Poetry Prize, and a finalist for both Los Angeles Times Book Prize and the Lambda Literary Award. Candy, a limited edition letterpress chapbook, The Main Cause of the Exodus, and The Morning Hour, selected by C.D. Wright for the 2003 Poetry Society of America's National Chapbook Fellowship. Her latest collection, Life in a Box, is a Pretty Life, was published by Nightboat Books in 2015. She's at work on a new book titled Good Stock, forthcoming from Coffee House Press. That is amazing. And we are so excited to have you here. Won't everyone please join me in welcoming Dawn?
Thank you so much for that wonderful introduction. Thank you all for coming. It's very warm. No one can say Nightboat Books, actually. It's like everyone stumbles. That's why I changed presses. I was like, fuck it, you know, nobody can say Nightboat Books. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna talk kind of in and around the process of I'm curating a series of videos here, and we'll show some of the work, and then, you know, it's about 20 minutes or so of that happening, 25 minutes, and then I'll read some poems. I'm reading off my iPad, which I have never done before, so, you know, give me a break if I screw it up. So, the title, and this is in, I think it's in like three sections. The title of this talk is called How to Grieve and Dream at the Same Time. Over the past year or so, I've been trying to work out some ideas about the relationship between discomfort and creativity. And it's called upon when I gave a lecture at the Jack Kerouac School of Disembodied Poetics at Naropa University last year, ideas on how to grieve and dream at the same time. So every time I'm given the chance, like here, to try to push those ideas further through the lens of whatever I'm working on, in this case, curating a series of videos for this museum, I try to keep tossing around and up the ideas that are currently unsettled. So I appreciate this opportunity to continue to gnaw on them with you and to work through them. And I'm grateful to Professor Mitch McEwen for inviting me to collaborate with her on Detroit House Opera on this exhibition and other exciting ventures. And thanks to the museum for all of its efforts in making the exhibition happen. I want to begin with some of the philosophical concerns that initially roughly framed our thinking for the segment of videos that I bring together. Mitch suggested Deleuze's idea of lines of flight, which struck me then and strikes me now as an extremely apt intermediary between poetics and architecture. The videos would, I think this is Mitch's language, poetically explore lines of flight or liberation from normal bodies or other problems of norms. I began to think, and I am thinking a lot about how the recognizability of those bodies makes it so that bodies get categorized, organized, repressed, brutalized, and erased, or conversely, elevated and celebrated. This is what Deleuze says. Lines of flight are the bolts of pent-up energy that break through the cracks in a system of control and shoot off on the diagonal. By the light of their passage, they reveal open spaces beyond the limits of what exists. Deleuze links human creativity to that kind of flight. The videos I selected have an eye not only toward the act of making, but also toward the collision of image and text. For me, part of the work that they do is to foreground the relationship between what is uttered or spoken out loud and the image that's present that you can see. And it's in Amir George's Moments of Intention, that we have the added tension of translation and inevitable slippage between the first language and the second, although that's kind of a reduction, one language and another, and what resides in between. The artistic productions that excite me most bring us to a consideration of not what's immediately legible or accessible, or what can be easily received, digested, deciphered, and then regurgitated, because those are modes of the logics of ordinary life and rationality, and it is those modes that bring us to the inevitable repressed or subjugated state in which what was once not norm becomes the norm. Think of how now in our culture, when the black body, the personhood of the black body, and then the physical living, breathing form of the black body is rigorously annihilated, and then the pornography of how it is then unattended to. How once it is made brutally breathless and bloody and silent, it lies limp for our ostentatious viewing, no one touching the it. Instead, the patience of protocols and officiality in its place. A body that is replaced by paperwork, by legal regimes. And then we say over again, I'm not surprised. The stuff that does excite me in art and poetry is what's illegible, abstract, noisy, invisible, that unknowable interaction that pulls us from our passive resting and knowing and unsurprised state and into the active state of engagement, thinking, and creating. These points of interest for me are analogous to my propositions for thinking about the person. We're used to thinking about the persons, the body of the person, the body's surface as a knowable thing, that it is somehow readable by the color of its skin, its size, its gait, its perceived gender, its speech. What do I know of the you inside you, and what do you know of the me inside me? To begin to rid ourselves and culture of these cultural and discursive fallacies that animate thinking of knowability, to break up and break down the norm so inscribed as to become object and material. I mean, the thing that I think about that is like, there's like a point at which like what is said actually becomes like so inscribed in our bodies that it like transforms from language into actual material, into actual, not only bodily material, but other kinds of material in the world. Is this perhaps where flight occurs, lines becoming curves, or more radically, swerves, when we break that down? So I'm going to show Moments of Intention, which is, I think, about a 5-minute video by Amir George, and then I'll come back and talk a little more.
Quand l'hiver finira, je prendrai ma route.
I was born here, I've lived here, I've loved here. Family, who do you think you are?
Séchant encore la glace fondue au-dessus de ma tête. Les taches de sel créent le cosmos. Chaque brin de verdure apparaît puissant. La lumière du soleil est toujours derrière les nuages. Quand on se déplace vers l'avant, on émet une vibration. On va continuer de bouger.
If you have 10,000 choices, how will you spend? How will you spend them in time?
Le mouvement, c'est la voix du miroir. Les membranes, elles, créent l'écho.
It's nothing but the devil!
Les vibrations ondulent dans les miroirs.
Against the cold and hunger and thirst, all that's left is vanity and excess. Yeah, vanity and excess. Now, you can look cool and all, but don't you stumble, boy.
Je fusionne mon énergie avec la présence éternelle.
Less time to do a thing right than to explain why you did it wrong. You know? Like Hiawatha.
Plus profondément, plus haut, plus profondément, plus haut.
Now my wholeness comes from striving. Striving to see, rather to be seen. Striving to know, rather to be known.
Les subtiles sécrétions de la vie.
Your world is as big as you make it.
Les épanouissements, la floraison, la respiration. Chuchotant, se réveillant. Imaginez.
So I'm not going to talk too directly or explicitly about the videos themselves. We can circle back around to that at the end during the Q&A if you want to. I'm just going to talk through some of the conversations that I had with the artists. What is more disruptive to the Western fantasy of itself than this black or brown body that lurks or hulks, the one that opens and spills, that is uncontained and uncontainable, unbreakable, apparently, brutal, apparently, the one that threatens the imaginary fabric that weaves us all together? But what is a black body if we can imagine it outside of that context and imagine instead a person as a culture? We can imagine a person. Is the person possible given the set of constraints and restraints, batteries and eliminations that threaten its existence? The black body is turned into object, not person, the moment it enters a social sphere, the moment the pre-person has an encounter with the public. But what does that mean? When is that? I think about babies, little brown babies, newly born and mostly covered, held close to someone's chest or tucked inside of a stroller. They do not yet know themselves as beings, if you believe Lacan, cannot yet recognize themselves as independent from the mother, have not yet incorporated eternal lack into the psyche or glimpsed the soul-splicing void. For the black body, one must recognize oneself as a self, and then one is forced to recognize oneself as a black self and overdetermine subjectivity, subject to being as over-interrogated as it is overwritten. Whenever this happens, that recognition of the black overdetermined self, that is also the moment of impossibility. This is one anchor for my thinking about impossibility in both the theoretical framework that I'm presenting here and that I'm trying to think through, but also in what I call the actual, which is to say the experience of material as it encounters the world. The impossible as a fissure in one's existence, the way this thing we call race is a kind of pathology that we have no alternative but to embrace. Recently, I wrote a short piece for the March issue of Harper's Magazine on the student protest happening on several college campuses. That seems like a long time ago now, strangely. In it, I quote my mother, who's in her 80s, who claims she has never experienced a single moment of racism. I know that this is impossible, that she grew up in the Jim Crow South. My father, dead now, who also grew up in the Jim Crow South, hated other black people, especially recent immigrants. He thought people from the Caribbean who had recently moved into our neighborhood were ruining it. My father was not a man of privilege. He was undereducated, working class, dark-skinned, and also insular, meaning he never seemed to reflect on himself, at least out loud. He never talked about the past, about his growing up, except once when he mentioned working in the, quote, fields as a boy of 5 or 6. What am I when I am a self-subjugating body? Do I have agency? Am I making something, or am I reiterating some entrenched idea of myself? While my parents, however sociopathic in the relationship to black identity, seemed to need to distance themselves from the black body, from blackness, and why wouldn't they? The object, so disparaged. I was keenly aware of what we as a culture were beginning to call difference. I cling to the impossible object, the body that is my container and what we call black. But I felt distance from any knowing about the black self beyond its impossibility. What is being black besides an impossible location for selfhood? If this is true, if the black body is an impossible location for selfhood, what lines of flight are possible? My mother's denial, my father's self-hatred, to disavow the disparaged container that carries you, the you in you, and teeters on the edge of madness. In Sune Wood's A Feeling of Chaos, which is the next video that you'll see, we begin in a moment of possible leisure inside of a possible photograph, which would have been shown, which is a quote from the film, would have shown her in a relaxed position, seated comfortably in the big visitor's chair covered with leathers from animals that grew on planets 100 light years away. What does she see, this visitor from outer space, from a potential future? Is it necessary to be from out of space? What does this indicate about what kind of imagination or dreaming is necessary in order to swerve from what we have recognized as the subjugated norm? So now we'll show, it's about a 3.5 minute video, A Feeling of Chaos by Sune Woods. And it's supposed to be, what you're gonna see is a split frame, but it is actually dual projection. So one of the projections is supposed to be on that wall and one on this wall, just so you know.
A photograph would have shown her in a relaxed position, seated comfortably in the big visitor's chair, covered with leathers from animals that grew on planets 100 light years from here.
A photograph would have shown her in a relaxed position, seated comfortably in the big visitor's chair, covered with leathers from animals that grew on planets 100 light years away.
Low-intensity conflicts target civilian populations rather than territory. They often combine force with propaganda campaigns.
No tengo miedo.
I'm not afraid.
I want to go back to this question of when and where the black body enters social space broadly conceived. I'm referring, I suppose, to the first recognition of blackness in the encounter with another, or that moment when, as Claudia Rankine says, one is, quote, rendered hyper-visible by, in this case, the awareness of one's blackness as perceived through the eyes of another. We suffer, says Rankine, from the condition of being addressable. But in this non-linguistic moment of which I write, where there is no verbal address, the black body has to negotiate what's being imposed and recognized without language, which makes for, of course, an inevitable slippage between perception and projection. It itches in this gap, but this gap is also productive of black social life, constructed in part because of the tension inside of this slippage and certainly in relationship to it. Is this moment of discomfort also a moment of creation, of innovation? Can it be that from the second the black body enters social space, is perceived as black, and incorporates a seeing of another, that this is also the first instance of radical self-creation? What does this have to do with creativity writ large, you might be wondering? Impossibility is the uncomfortable space I am imagining here. It is the space in which my poetics do their work. It is a space from which poetry emerges. The impossible speech, what might be also called silence, compelled by trauma. What speech do we have when we are crawling around on the kitchen floor? I am thinking here of death and what happens in its wake. What do we say when the loved one is lost, unreachable? What language is left? Or where do we end language? Are we at its end? If we are at its end, then what else can occur? When my father died, he was very small, melting almost into death. I could not reach him, so he came to me, first as a green light under the bed, then as a tall black man in a cowboy hat at a bar. He sent messages through the man. I said nothing, but this nothing was also something, a thing between the transient process and the gravity of absence. The nothing was a without language, but not a no thing, quite the opposite, breathing up through fissures. What kind of speech could possibly attend to the melancholia of the racially marked body, perennially trying to gather itself, make itself whole and true, despite the effort to obliterate it, make it stab itself in its own eye? Impossibility, especially given its irreconcilability, its discomfort, might be the fact, in fact, what compels or calls forth the creative. Impossibility, especially given its irreconcilability, its discomfort, might in fact be what compels or calls forth the creative. This is a condition of making from a place of not knowing. So now we'll see the first 4 minutes of Ronaldo V. Wilson. He's a poet and visual artist. We'll see the first 4 minutes of his film, Gray.
The sea leaves glistening, I am listening. The sea leaves glistening, I am frightened. I am fearful and perplexed. I am contained and contagious. There is a to co-opt your imagination. Understands this co-optation across the reference of your imaginative desire. I feel that somehow unbound by this moment more distinctively between one kind of scene and another.
Grave by the poet and visual artist Ronaldo V. Wilson begins in what I like to call the poultice time. He is singing in a freestyling sort of way while drawing a noose with his fingers. There's some approach here in conversation with Amir George's work in that both pieces are engaging in presenting, at least in one of the fields or planes, the image of someone making something. But Wilson's piece for me is the most discomforting in both its attention to the overlaying of spoken language. It's a little low here, but it's like song, poem, and visible text happening at the same time. And it's physical contortions and morphing of the physical body. What or who is the person with the hair and the heels and notably the mask? So because I'm going to read some poems after this, I'm going to kind of shorten this ending. I've truncated it a little bit, but I'm turning to poet and theorist Joan Retallack, who writes about the swerve in her book, The Poetical Wager. And this is a long quote from her. Life is subject to swerves, sometimes gentle, often violent, out of the blue motions that cut obliquely across material and conceptual logics. If everything were hunky-dory, it might not be so impossible to attend to them. As it is, they afford opportunities to usefully rethink habits of thought. She goes on to ask, how can we frame a poetics of the swerve, a constructive preoccupation with what are unpredictable forms of change? One might begin by stating this. What they all have in common is an unsettling transfiguration of once familiar terrain. They tend to produce disorientations, even estrangement, by radically altering the geometries of attention. I've quoted Retallack at length because I think that this is a kind of thinking hugely important to our ability in the creative act to hold both grief and dreaming at the same time. In the radical act of radical artistic productions, I think we can do even more than that. I might be delusional. We can help reimagine physical space, which is to say, remake the world. Thank you. Tequila is making me tipsy. I mean, let's see if I can now pull up some poems. Yeah, that's not it. Talk amongst yourselves. Hold on for one sec. Oh, is there Wi-Fi? Do you want to help me sign in? great. Okay, so again, thanks for your attention. Thanks for coming. I guess we're gonna have Q&A at some point. Hopefully I'll be able to answer your questions. I mean, I have no idea. You know, I have no idea what your questions will be, but I'll just read, you know, a few poems. These are, so in the title of the book is now actually called, the new book is called Good Stock, Strange Blood. And it is kind of a mix of things. And when I met Mitch McEwen, we were in this group of global artists called How Do You Say I'm an African? And I wrote some of these poems as a part of the work that I did with them on a kind of experimental opera installation piece. We can talk more about that if you want to talk about that too. I don't want to talk about that right now. So anyway, so some of these poems have titles. I'll try to indicate the titles, and then there are these moments in between that are untitled. And I'll do this for like 15 minutes or so. I'm gonna take off my jacket. This is like the poet. You know, this is how you know that the poet part is coming. It's also, it's fucking hot up here. Now put it on. I got it. Okay. Aglow, this bent body, itch of layer, not of hair, they call us Negro. To stand broad-footed in sensation of being lit up. No monument, only blood earth, warm salve to open a throat bone. How to live between mother and time, as if born into the self, watching the self already made formless, then out of clay, feel the hump of our drape, hear the body, flesh, inevitable, the unsatiated hunger like a whip. Instrumental fissure, instrumental fish, whose rasp, a whip, a book, a story left in the dark body. To reach fingers out toward shine of morning, eyes squinted and find there only cord grass, some smoke or a warning. He said, if they would only just beat me or shoot me, but they wanted soul substance to harbor that like that so I could never move from this place. They reached cracked hands inside and hold me open for raking. Our name. What is our name? Where are the buttons holding us in place? What is place outside of time, outside of memory, unstitched, unsnatched, swell into our mother's blackened skin, her tarnished whiteness, her rope shackled to grandfather's black neck. A picket, a thicket, rice, cotton, sugar, potatoes, cowpeas, turnips, and rye. Oh Lord, thank you, Mr. Hopeton, not selling my boy. This is the body bending over the nether. Textures, we know them. Bruises or our Mrs. homespun cape, linen hung by its lips sway, a useless body, trash boy. What is a dance for being? A step toward nothingness, gray, landscape, purple feet. I remember, I swear, the limp relative to nothing. Remnants bright against sea. Migrant legs almost drowned already. A narrative wired in cells, desolate root. We succumbed. head by measure, by weight of black sheath in Oregon's legacy that lingers a hip thrust. We wait in wings, expanse spread across darkening blue sky. We shut shades, huff into wings, shrink bones of self. What you drag, your banjo, your braided necklace, disappearance into mole, stink of flesh become flesh, arms and arches open to pocket all dejected souls. In play or games or anticipation, what it means to live almost primarily in this space in order to escape the ordinary state of anxiety. What allows the body to survive, to maintain an unpunctured exterior? What is wholeness if we were never whole? The baby book. Well, this is a section. Baby book is a section. To be in covering. To be in covering is the problem. Hunger caverns under this leather wrap from destitution, from split skull. Mother as brown as brawn and braided toward filth beneath skin like wire, all our kin. From before, it happened when dust underfoot, red dick stuck under guise of reason. Who summons us from darkness, from water well, one philtrum stitched to will of tongue? Who tugs and rocks us, suckles wet mouth? We is the purpose of the falling, swollen, our teeth hurt their constant cutting, warm when sucking. Sunken, wanted the swell of black earth, a legacy, something larger than ourselves to hold us. If I were looking from the outside, I think that a thing so ancient would not pulse so loudly, would be automatically removed from the atmosphere. Lose its atomic structure, its relatability. We were driven, or we were rode hard, mule-like on feathers. This notion of sustainability, black vultures everywhere, neat white stars under their wings, good at cleaning up road carcasses. What a mess, your weak veins, your lifelong addictions. What you then must witness is the vulture devouring the exposed red and fly-soaked, unrecognizable. The book of repression. All the stuff brilliantly cocking my throat. No dream remembered, no past reconstructed. He called it a kiss, but that was no kiss. Rises, dead breath into smoke. The writing is not balm. The eye in sleep is unreachable flesh, subtle flesh, skin warm milk, marsh grass, its simplicity without warning. In my early 30s, I had one recurring dream, so vivid it began to feel like a memory rather than a dream. It's the only dream worth recounting. At some point, I no longer held the dream, just the memory of the dream, and often I'd get confused as to the nature of non-dreamed life. In a giant old abandoned house at the top of a hill, it's night and I am furtively burying a man's body under some floorboards. I pull up the floorboards and then I'm outside digging a grave with my hands. It's easy, this digging, and I know there will be no evidence of this activity. I'm free to carve out soil in big, rough scoops. Even though I know I won't get caught, my body is racked by guilt. I cannot stop. The burial is necessary and compelled, so I scrape the earth, bludgeon it with bloody fingers, and then place his body into the shallow grave, replacing the floorboards. No one will ever know. Elision into vowels, sunken time, O sounds, ow, short, flat, A, for as long as. My brother bends away from the hose that beats him. Basement is a watery place. I think of privacy in houses, what they allow for, their intimacy of enclosure. We never heard a word from over there, and they never heard a word from us. How the home seals off the world, creates a hole in the world, and there is no joy in that. To watch a teenage boy compressed and the heart still beats, his hiss is what hatred made. God will not save you. Fetish object. Deploy sensory mechanism. Deploy sound cannon. Blow their fucking eardrums out. Shoot them at close range if you can. Rationale of the uninterrogated actual. In the side yard, bright wind takes up sprinklers, sprinkles in sunlight. I call for my stranger. I long for him. I look for him in the face of every black ghost on the edge of every piss-stinking park. Can taste Bacardi breath, the long toe of it lapping against skin, pressure in what can't happen and does. An imprint. How the slender living room window looks out onto the street. A sofa perpendicular to window in front of my TV. The kitchen table for mica, my feet dangling. Or was it the motel that one time? Who knows? Who doesn't say wait into a room of bicycles where the children fetch their toys? A thing you don't want can make you ravenous, can open the sturdiest lip in its faint presence. Thank you.